Welcome to church this morning.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service.
Well, good morning from me as well. My name's Reverend Tom Webber, and it's great to welcome you to our service here this morning. For the last couple of weeks, I've done the notices from my living room, so I decided to come into Christchurch this morning to do them. But I can tell you it's pretty cold in here, but never mind. One or two notices as we begin our service. Next week, our Deanery Service of Light, to which I know some of you have been, is going to be available online this year. You'll find the details of how to get to it on the back of the connected sheet, or it's on our website under What's On and then Events. Do join with us as we look at that together. Also to say, you'll probably appreciate this has been a tough time for us financially, and I want to thank each one of you for your giving to our churches. The PCC at Christchurch has just approved a budget where we're expecting something like a deficit of £15,000 this year if everything remains the same. The situation at Emmanuel is probably at a similar level. So thank you very much for your giving. And as we remind ourselves, all things come from you, O Lord, and of your own do we give you. Just to say, here at Christchurch, Nikki Baldwin has set up a couple of lovely prayer stations. We'll be telling you a bit more about those in the Connected magazine. But do come in if you like in the mornings and have a quiet time using them. Today is our communion service, so you may want to make preparations for that. But just as we begin, let's have a pause as we come into God's presence now. And so we begin with our first hymn, Jesus is the name we honour.
We will glorify, we will live.
And so we sing the words of the hymn, Jesus is the name we honour. But it was Jesus himself who quoted the prophet Isaiah when he said, these people honour me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. We can all be guilty of that, myself included. And so together, let's come to God and confess. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you and me. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now I'm going to have a brief interview with a member of the Christchurch congregation, Rosanne Shoji, who's a member of Public Health England.
So, Rosanne, thank you for joining us. I'd love to sit and have a coffee with you, but it's all on Zoom these days. Could you tell us a tiny bit about what your role is?
Yeah, thanks, Tom. Well, I work for Public Health England, which I suspect most people had never heard of a year ago, but everybody's quite familiar. It's mentioned a lot in press conferences and daily briefings and all sorts of things. I work in the Southwest Centre, which is based in Bristol, and we've obviously had an extremely busy year. Public Health England is a organisation which sits in the background generally, and we, our sort of strapline is protect and improve the nation's health. And I tend to do the improvement bit, but certainly in the first 6 months of the pandemic, I did a lot of health protection and spent a lot of my time sitting where I am now, which is Katrina's old bedroom, manning the call centre and taking calls from across the region on talking to people, actually mainly people in care homes, quite stressed and trying to divert their inquiries into the most appropriate part of Public Health England. So that was the initial 3 months, which was quite stressful, I have to say.
So how, I mean, this is an exceptionally demanding time for you, but perhaps personally, Rosanne, how have you found it? How has it been for you?
Yeah, well, I would say certainly the first 3-4 months from March last year, I haven't physically actually been in our office in Bristol since the 10th of March. Yeah. So we've been exclusively working at home remotely. And as I said, I actually picked up really a new job for the first 4 months of the pandemic, but had to learn that remotely because we were all spread out across the Southwest. So that was a real challenge. I think, however, the team really pulled together. We're a really supportive, Public Health England's a really supportive organisation to work for. And the team that I work for is also very supportive. And I think that was really helpful. But it was long hours and quite stressful. And I have to say, I'm quite glad that we've sort of got ourselves a lot more organised as the months have gone on and the hours have become more bearable. And I've gone back to more of the work that I would have done previously.
Okay, that's really good news. Rosanne, you obviously were not out of it yet by a long way.
No.
And no doubt there'll be a lot more work to do. Are there one or two things we could be praying for you at the moment?
Yeah, well, I think really that we keep going, not only me, but the team. I would, to be honest, pray initially for the whole of Public Health England. I think the organisation itself has been put under a great deal of pressure. We've been lambasted in the press and blamed for a lot of the things that have gone wrong. And when you're working really hard and doing your best and actually being told, we're a government agency, so basically we do what the government tells you to do, to find that when you open the paper that Public Health England is being consistently criticised, it's very hard on the staff and on me personally as well to have that. So just to bear us up in your prayers, that would be really helpful. And I think going forward, just we're in a period of transition and trying to work through how we recover from this. In the middle, it's still going on, but we're already looking at what we've learnt during the COVID pandemic can be transferred into how we work more. And particularly from the work I do is how to improve the health of the most vulnerable in our population. I think COVID has really highlighted the fact that we've got massive health inequalities in our country. That's something not new to public health, but something that we're really trying to think about.
Okay. So, well, yeah. If I pray now, that'll be a start. So Heavenly Father, we pray for Public Health England, particularly for an increase in morale. It's easy to criticise people, we all know that. And Lord, I thank you very much for the work this department have done in extremely challenging situations. We pray for strength and we pray for wisdom for them as they get through this and also plan for the future. But also for Roseanne in her particular role within it. Thank you for her calmness, for her hard work, for her judgment and wisdom. And we pray you would strengthen her day by day with these incessant calls that she has to do. Just pray that you would be her strength and guide her forwards and help her know day by day up in that little bedroom that you are with her and are with her every step of the way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Roseanne, thank you very much.
No problem.
And now our Bible reading is brought to us by Dina Parker, and then Terry will give us this morning's sermon.
A reading from Acts chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. The Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were, staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in his own native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Jerusalem, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, 'What does this mean?' Some, however, made fun of them and said, 'They've had too much wine.' Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. This week saw the end of the presidency of Donald Trump, a new chapter beginning in the history of America. And many of the people there must be hoping that Donald Trump will go peacefully and quietly, that things will settle down now. I hope so too, though I'm not quite sure. It gives me an insight as to how the authorities and the powers that be in first century Jerusalem must have hoped the same about Jesus. They thought that his death might silence the contentious preaching. But then there were the rumours about his resurrection, his coming back to life. And now, just as they hoped some news story would make the front page, there was the great kerfuffle at the bank holiday weekend of Pentecost. What a strange event. Big winds, flames of fire, and a great discussion amongst all the multicultural community of pilgrims there. What was going on? Everyone wanted to know, especially those who were there. These rough lads from up north were speaking about Jesus in a language the hearers could understand. Now, it wasn't ordinary speaking in tongues. When the Spirit of God moves someone to worship or prophecy in a spiritual language, this was more like the instant translation they have at the United Nations meetings, but that happens with crowds of interpreters fluent in at least 2 languages. This was done, the translation, by ordinary people, so the crowd could hear about Jesus in words they understood. So Luke explains to us and tells us of Peter's explanation. Luke was the writer who, having had a great hit with the good news or gospel of Jesus, followed it up with his second book, The Acts That Happened Next. In his gospel, chapter 1 sees the birth of John the Baptist, chapter 2 sees the birth of Jesus, and chapter 3 sees John baptize Jesus. But this was no ordinary baptism, as John the Baptist knew. He was symbolically washing people as a sign of their repentance of wrongdoing and their desire for God's forgiveness. But Jesus comes, and he is baptized to show he identifies with us sinful people. But the Spirit of God visibly comes upon him to show that he is also divine and that God's presence is in him. The rest of Luke's book tells of Jesus as the embodiment of God's Spirit, reaching out to everyone as he teaches, he heals, he dies for us and rises again. So in chapter 1 of his second book, Luke picks up the story. Chapter 1 tells how Jesus ascends back to heaven as his work is complete. And chapter 2 shows how everyone is now baptized with the Holy Spirit. a great deluge of spiritual power in wonder and words to show that everyone who belongs to Jesus has the Spirit of God. And this Spirit is for everyone. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, Cappadocians, northern lads from Galilee, Bristolian, Possets, and even people in Western Supermare. Peter summarizes what Jesus did and quotes from the prophet Joel that it was always God's intention to pour out his Spirit on all people. Peter says this is what has now happened, and the rest of Luke's second book tells of what all those who belong to Jesus did in the power of the Holy Spirit. Pentecost for the Jewish people was the festival of the first harvest of the year, the wheat harvest, but also a reminder to Jewish people that they belong to God because of the covenant with Moses. Now Pentecost for Christians becomes the first harvest of the new people of God, those who belong to God's people through Jesus, wherever they were in the world. Here it begins with multicultural Jerusalem, but it's even for the great unwashed Gentiles all around the world, as Luke explains to people when someone wants to build a wall or something to keep the riffraff out. So what makes someone a Christian is not going to church, not reading the Bible. It's not confessing what we do wrong and receiving God's forgiveness through Christ. What makes someone a Christian is having the Spirit of Jesus in you because you have acknowledged him as your Lord and God. Belief is a start. Confessing our sins is a beginning, and something we regularly have to do, perhaps. But the real centre of the Christian life is that those things bring us into fellowship with God through the presence of his Spirit in us. It's knowing God in our lives. Those in authority, when they question Peter and John, note that they had been with Jesus. But actually, that's not quite what they were dealing with now. They had been with Jesus, but that the Holy Spirit of Jesus is now with them every day. And that is the presence that we can all have. We're all going to get an invitation. The invitation asks us to make an appointment to get an injection. But it's the vaccine that can protect us from this deadly virus. I'm waiting for mine, and some of you I know have not only got your invitation, but you've accepted it and been vaccinated. But the vaccine is for everyone. It's just going to the most needy, first of all. We can all get it, and we all need it. The vaccine works unseen inside you and prevents you from coming to harm. Getting the vaccine may prevent you getting the disease, but we do not think it will stop you passing it on to everyone. So we're not quite sure yet, but everyone needs to receive the vaccine. Two questions then leap out at me from this passage. The first is, how am I experiencing God's Spirit now? Not in the past. Where is the Spirit directing my life? Where am I blind, deaf, or unwilling to heed what he says? And I wonder how you'd answer that question as well. The second question concerns, how am I telling other people about this in a language they can understand? Are there people I dismiss or think wouldn't be interested? Who do I baffle by using jargon? Do they need to see my actions that will demonstrate what I say? Do I even need to use words? Surely in this day and age, I need both actions and words. But does my testimony that explains what Jesus means to me stop at the point I became a Christian? Or does it stop at yesterday, or maybe even better, today? So that I make people aware that it's the presence of God with me, Jesus' Spirit within me, that guides and directs my life. If the presence of the Holy Spirit is really essential to our Christian life, it must be active in my life and yours. But it's also necessary for everyone else as well. Let's pray. Lord, so fill us with your Holy Spirit that we may be aware of your presence in every area of our life. And give us the sense of listening to others, of choosing our words and our actions carefully, that we can demonstrate to them the presence of your Spirit is for them as well as ours. For we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Spirit.
And now Margaret Bailey will lead us in our intercessions.
Shall we pray together? Lord, we do indeed praise and thank you for all that you have done for us in Jesus Christ through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and minds. As we come to you each day, help us to lay our lives and circumstances before you, that you may reach out to us with your loving touch, so that we may come to know you better and have more confidence in our faith in you. Wherever we are in our Christian journey, may we be open to learn more of you and your will for us, and your power to change and empower our lives and the lives of those around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God and Father of all, we thank you for our freedom to follow Jesus Christ, but we are dismayed recently to see the lack of tolerance and the violence towards those who have differing views in the United States. We pray for reconciliation between the different political factions there and an understanding of your universal love and acceptance. We pray that the transition to a new presidency will continue peacefully, and that you will bless President Biden with integrity and leadership and reconciliatory skills, and an administration that will endeavour to support and encourage all its citizens. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, Lord, for a new year with new beginnings, and we pray especially for the Morrissey family as they prepare to relocate to this country this year, and especially for the children, for whom this will be a completely different way of life. Help them to adjust quickly to the changes and to make new friends quickly. Thank you for blessing their work in Bible translation in Senegal, and we pray that you will continue to lead them in their service of you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, Lord, for the hope you bring through the work and dedication of others, so that now, instead of just hearing of more people who are infected with COVID-19, this is balanced by hearing of those who have been vaccinated against the disease. We pray for healing for those who are ill, and that you would encourage those who are caring for them and who are worn down by the distressing situations they encounter every day. Help us to show them all our support in any small way we can. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Please join me now as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And so as we now prepare for communion, so we remember the words that Jesus himself spoke when he spoke about the coming of his Holy Spirit. This is John chapter 14. He said to his disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." And so may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
In a moment, we're going to say the words, "The Lord is here." And I guess as Meg has been talking about isolation, so it's very special to remember that wherever you are, God is present with you. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son. Because after he had descended into heaven and was seated at the right hand of your majesty, he sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit, that through his glorious power and presence, the joy of the good news might go out into all the world. So with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we praise you forever, saying,
"Holy, holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." Praise and thanks to you, Father in heaven. On the night before he died, your Son, Jesus Christ, took bread and wine. He gave thanks and said, "This is my body given for you. This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins." Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts and remember his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Feed us with his body and blood, that we may live and grow in him. Through him we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever.
Amen.
as we come towards the end of our service. So we begin to take what we've learned and heard and prayed about, and we take it into our week. This last song, Hear the Call of the Kingdom, is a call made to all who are Christians. In any country, men and women, boys and girls, all of us who have the Holy Spirit inside ourselves, a part of God's kingdom, part of his purposes for this world, part of to spread his love to others. Hear the call of the kingdom.
We'll teach it to you first couple of verses and then we'll go back to the beginning. So hear the call.
Hear the call.
To reach out to the lost.
Hear the call of the kingdom to reach out to the lost with the Father's compassion in the wonder of the cross. Bringing peace and forgiveness and a hope yet to come. Let the nations put their trust in him. King of heaven, we
And so picking up again Jesus' promise of the Holy Spirit in John 14. So he says, "All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you." And so may you know God's presence within your life. May you hear his words, his guidance, his encouragement. And may that strengthen you to live out your lives for him this week and beyond. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.